myocyte. So that results in these genetic abnormalities can result in abnormal contraction or abnormal relaxation. And they can also be associated with abnormal iron transport, and in so doing with arrhythmias. So having said that, as you will see as we go along, this is from the genetic point of view, but there are other things that can interfere with contraction or relaxation. So for instance, in one type, you will see that the heart becomes stiff, so it can't relax to fill, the ventricles can't relax to fill properly. This can be genetic, or it can be due to things infiltrating the heart. And you also see that arrhythmias, while it can be due to abnormal iron transportation, it can also be due to things like fibrosis in the area where, for instance, the AV node or its branches run. So let's look at a general list. So idiopathic cardiomyopathy used to be a much bigger list, but over time it has been shrinking as more and more genetic abnormalities are being discovered. So in that primary group, idiopathic is the percentage has been decreasing on a continuous basis. Of the ones we know, so we have known primary genetic causes now. It can be post-myocarditis, can be metabolic related to functional abnormality as in hyperthyroidism, or related to infiltration or storage disorders of the heart. Hemochromatosis is an iron abnormality where iron is stored in the heart. And amyloidosis is another disease where this compound called amyloid is produced and deposits in the heart muscle. Our storage disorder, an classic example, one of the more common ones, glycogen storage disease, affects the liver and multiple other organs, including heart. Drug toxicity, so doxorubicin and alcohol, I think, are two of the ones that we definitely want to cite. So alcohol is directly toxic to cells, and then there are some indirect consequences like, for instance, alcoholism. In alcoholism, you can have various types of B12 deficiency, and that can affect the heart muscle as well. Doxorubicin is a chemotherapy drug. It is in common use because it is one of the drugs in the protocol for the treatment of breast cancer. And as you know, we have breast cancer is one of the most common cancers. So doxorubicin is used a lot, not only in breast, there are other cancers that it's used in as well. And it is toxic to the heart. So patients who get doxorubicin, they actually have to track their cardiac function over time, I believe both during and post-treatment. Pregnancy, we'll come back to that in a while. Patients with muscular disease, like muscular dystrophy, so congenital muscular abnormalities, and those where you have infiltration like sarcoidosis, which I don't know if you remember, is a granulomatous inflammatory condition that is often in the lungs but can be in many other organs, including the heart. And then post-radiation, you can have fibrosis in the heart muscle. So let's just get it out of the way. Remember we said it is typically a disease of muscle, and the heart should not have structural abnormalities like congenital heart disease, for instance. But also, hypertension and ischemic heart disease in patients who have those, or other types of valvular abnormalities, including those related to congenital heart disease, other types of congenital heart disease, all of those can cause secondary myocardial dysfunction, but you cannot call them cardiomyopathy. And you definitely need to be aware, for instance, I think in the past they used to talk about hypertensive cardiomyopathy if the heart passes a certain size, but we're not to do that anymore. So in terms of classification, there are different classifications. There are different systems. There are different ways to approach it. So for instance, one way can be whether it's genetic or not, for instance, according to cause, for instance. But in this, like, I'm not sure how you will get taught it in your clinical lecture. But in this lecture, in pathology, we are focused on the structural abnormality and therefore that type of classification. So with that in mind, the original WHO classification from way back had three main types. Dilated, which makes up the majority, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and restrictive cardiomyopathy. And then in 2008, the European Society took that a little further. They maintained the three main types, added arrhythmogenic, which we'll briefly talk about today, and a group for those where it was difficult to classify them. And they acknowledged that they can be familial or non-familial, meaning it can run in families, like some hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, for instance, or it may not be familial. So please remember, familial and genetic are not the same thing. Familial is, it's running in your family. Genetic just means there's a genetic abnormality. It may or may not run in your family, okay? Okay, now you may get introduced to the American classification, which is a more complex version of what I'm showing you here. So these three types are illustrated in diagrammatic form here, and we come back to the diagrams, but the names in a way tell you what it is. So in dilated, there is dilatation of the heart. In hypertrophic, there is thickening of the left ventricle, sometimes also the right. And in restrictive, there is something that is interfering with relaxation of the muscle. So when the heart needs to be filled with oxygenated blood from the lung, that cannot happen comfortably because it's stiff and it won't relax to do that. In terms of the clinical disease that we see in these patients and their outcome, each pathologic type has a spectrum of severity. And there is often clinical similarity and overlap between the types. So all of them often lead to cardiovascular death, definitely if left unmanaged. Hypertrophic is the one where patients can go on for a long time with their disease without necessarily having any treatment. So things that can happen in general, progressive heart failure, well, with all of them, arrhythmias, sudden cardiac death, stroke from embolization, in those where there is left atrial dilatation, and I think you've done heart failure by now, whenever there is left atrial dilatation, there's risk for thrombus formation in that dilated atrium, and those thrombi can embolize around the body. The most dangerous of which is when they embolize to the brain and cause stroke. Repeat what, please? About the thrombi? Oh, I was saying that any heart where there is chronic left atrial dilatation, you can get thrombus formation in that dilated atrium, and then that thrombus can embolize to organs around the body, and if it goes to the brain, it will cause a stroke. Okay, so let's get into the specific types of cardiomyopathy now. So we start with dilated. So dilated cardiomyopathy, we mentioned, was by far the most common type. There are genetic and non-genetic acquired causes. The main thing in this condition is progressive dilatation and decreasing ability for the ventricles, especially the left, to contract. So this condition has systolic dysfunction. And clearly, if your ventricle cannot contract to force the blood out to the systemic circulation, then the patient is in heart failure. And this heart failure is progressive over time, and these patients typically eventually require transplantation. The ventricular wall thickness is normal or reduced. So the underlying things are the key things I want you to remember about this particular condition. Unfortunately, dilated cardiomyopathy is usually at an advanced stage by the time the diagnosis is made. So I'll give you an example. A couple years ago, I think, we had a patient. This was my patient. I was on autopsy service. So he was 40-something, and he had like this three-month history of severe, intractable, progressive heart failure. He had cardiomegaly. And he got sent from Spanish Town to the Heart Institute, I think, for them to do his echo and all the related investigations. But when he arrived there, he was in severe ventricular arrhythmias. They couldn't control it. They sent him up to our emergency room. They couldn't control it, and he died in our emergency room. And what we found at autopsy was dilated cardiomyopathy. Okay, so this is one way that these patients in the adult population can present. So here are the causes. Dilated cardiomyopathy is the one with a long list of causes, including genetic and then non-genetic acquired, and that includes a multitude of secondary causes. So if we start over here, remember we said idiopathic, the term still exists, but it's rapidly shrinking as they discover more and more genes. So this group is the group that's growing the most, primary genetic dilated cardiomyopathy. It can be post-myocarditis, viral myocarditis. And then you saw some of these causes before, metabolic, those relate causing extreme physiologic stress, like hypothyroidism, pheochromocytoma, which is a tumor that secretes adrenaline and its metabolites, cocaine, drug toxicity we mentioned, pregnancy. Just a little note. So there is this peripartum cardiomyopathy that is discovered. Peripartum means around the time of birth, so just before or after. And they have dilatation of the heart sometimes, and they definitely have systolic dysfunction. So they have poor contraction, and it's of uncertain cause. But they are wondering about an abnormality in one of the genes that's also related to primary dilated cardiomyopathy. So the age range is wide. It includes infants, different types, but it's mainly seen in the 20 to 50 year age group. So from a genetic point of view, of last publication in our book, this is changing as we speak, about 30 to 50% of these cases are familial. This can be with autosomal dominant inheritance, and that's the main way we're seeing it so far. Can also be X-linked, can be autosomal recessive. We have passed 20 genes that have been identified, and they encode proteins for things like the cytoskeleton, the sarcolemma, the nuclear envelope of these cardiac muscle cells. And this results in defects of force generation, force transmission, and signaling between the myocytes. So you can understand why contraction is a problem. Just to mention one specific type, a shrinking group, idiopathic dilated cardiomyopathy in children. So typically, these are infants. They're often less than a year. They can be over a year. One of the patients I had in the last 10 years was about 18 months. Actually, I'm gonna show you her heart at the end of the session. So I wasn't supposed to tell you that. So you already know one answer. So frequently they have this history of respiratory or diarrheal type illness, so in other words, of a viral illness. And then they develop heart failure. This accounts for about 5% of heart-related deaths in children. Mechanisms include cardiogenic shock, arrhythmias, intractable cardiac failure, and pulmonary dysfunction. So in this condition, the heart is large and globular. It's obviously dilated, the muscle tends to be flabby, so it's soft, and it can be greater than 2 to 3 times the normal weight for age. In dilated cardiomyopathy, very importantly, typically, the muscle wall thickness is normal or decreased. Another classic finding, endocardial fibroelastosis, and this causes thickening of the endocardium. You get white, opaque thickening. I'll show you in a minute. And they are not contracting to release blood from the ventricles, so blood backs up in the atrium. So over time, they can have thrombi, and these thrombi, of course, can embolize. On histology, we can prove that the thickened endocardium is from fibroelastosis. So in other words, there is fibrous tissue and elastic tissue that is in the endocardium, which is normally very thin, and this makes it get thick. There are patches of fibrosis within the myocardium itself, and you can see scattered hypertrophic muscle cells, although the wall is not thick. So we saw this diagram earlier, normal compared to dilated, much larger hearts with dilated ventricles. And here is an actual heart. So this relatively normal, because to be honest, I think there could be some thickening of the left ventricle here. But relatively normal, just to show you, compared to this markedly enlarged dilated heart with biventricular dilatation in this case, both right and left ventricles, and then because they can't empty properly, the atria also have become dilated. Okay, so that's dilated cardiomyopathy. So now, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So this one is a primary genetic disease of myocardium. Unlike dilated, which could be primary and genetic, it could be non-genetic acquired, it could be, as a part of that, it could be secondary. This is just a primary genetic condition. So it is due to mutations in any one of the genes for proteins of the cardiac myocyte sarcomere. About 50% of cases are familial and typically inherited as an autosomal dominant trait. In about 50% of cases, there is a new mutation, but then thereafter, it can be inherited in an autosomal dominant fashion. The incidence is about 1 in 500. Some studies go as high as 1 in 200. I'm not sure if that has to do with particular ethnic populations. Can be seen in infants to adults. So this might be an introduction. On Wednesdays, not every Wednesday, some Wednesdays, if you get FMS emails, you may have started to see them. So on Wednesdays, when there is one, we have what's called clinical pathological conference. So you guys were not blessed to meet Professor Hanscher, because he was actively teaching up to the day that he died. But he used to say, if you go to as many of those during medical school, you're comfortable at the end, not only to pass that exam, but to start managing patients and feel fairly comfortable. Because we discuss all sorts of cases, sometimes it's topics, the departments rotate. So every week for the 4 standard weeks of the month can be surgery, ONG, pediatrics, who am I forgetting? Medicine. And it rotates every month. And sometimes when we have exams, they may have the external examiner be the guest speaker. Sometimes people invite a guest. Yes? Oh, I don't know. I don't know about that, because now that we have bigger classes, how big is your class? Yeah, now that we have bigger classes over years, people get divided and moved around, so I'm not sure. I don't know anything about how that works out. Definitely at some point, you will get divided. Even in my time, there were a few things we got divided for, like surgery. We went to a couple different institutions. And community health. We went out into various communities and spent time. Okay, CPC, Clinical Pathological Conference, FMS sends out, when we have one, an email usually goes out from FMS on at least Monday, if not before. So the reason I'm bringing it up is, last Wednesday, we presented a case of a neonate from an infant of a diabetic mother, which is a risk factor for this condition in the neonatal period, or to have it as a congenital disorder. And so this infant had very classic hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Having said that, infancy is not the most common time, and it's not as common in the first 2 decades, or at least they don't present, because remember, it's genetic. A lot of them present after the first 2 decades of life. So, grossly, there is often cardiomegaly. Then, classically, you would find asymmetrical left ventricular hypertrophy. This is important because many conditions cause symmetrical left ventricular hypertrophy. And symmetrical means that when we make a slice anterior to posterior across the ventricles, the thickening of the left ventricle, which includes the free wall and the septum, is uniform around. Asymmetrical means that at some point, somewhere is thicker than another part.
So it's symmetrical hypertrophy, the same as concentric?
Yes, same as concentric, yes. So, in this condition, the septum, especially the subaortic septum, can be thicker than the posterior ventricular wall. So in general, because to be honest, the measurement is not done in the subaortic region, it's done by the apex. In general, the septum is thicker than the posterior free wall of the ventricle. But the whole thing is thick. So this narrows the cavity of the ventricle. And some people talk about banana-like left ventricular cavity. And then there's obstruction to the outflow tract of the left ventricle. So I'm going to show you this in a minute. And sometimes the hypertrophy is biventricular. So the infant we looked at last Wednesday, that infant had thickening of the right ventricle as well. So on histology, there is muscle fiber disarray. So the bundles of muscle in the myocardium, especially in the septum, they flow parallel to each other. So if you look at a histology slide of septum, you just see all the muscle running parallel to each other. But in this condition, the bundles of muscle cells, they start to cross each other. They can even make little cartwheel whirls. And that is a characteristic histological finding. Otherwise, not so specific, you can have patchy fibrosis in the myocardium, especially as the heart gets bigger, because some of this fibrosis is ischemic as the muscle outruns the blood supply. And then, of course, you'd have lots of hypertrophic myocytes. So in diagrammatic form again, so we can compare to the dilated one. This one, it is restricted to the left ventricle. You can see the marked thickening of the septum and the free wall. And now here it is. Here is a classic case in photo. This is obviously either an explant or from autopsy. So let's orient ourselves. So in this scenario, a section was made. It's like they held a heart, pretending that the apex is the bottom. Because you know in reality it's not. You've done anatomy of the heart, right? Right, so just for convenience, they put the apex at the bottom. So when you do that, the two atria are of course superior. So blood comes in right atrium, cross the tricuspid valve, into the right ventricle. And not seen in this view because of where we're more posterior with this cut, then it will go out the pulmonary. Then it gets oxygenated, goes to the lung, comes back. Left atrium. So if you follow the arrow, across the mitral valve, down. If you notice, this ventricular cavity is very narrow. Here is the septum, here is the free wall, it's all very thick. The other thing to notice, this is the aorta. The aortic valve is somewhere around here. So here is the septum in the sub-aortic region, in other words, just under the aortic valve. This is where it's the thickest in this patient. And that is the classic scenario. And then here it is, still too thick, but just not as thick. So this bulge of muscle bulges into the ventricular cavity and the outflow tract and narrows the outflow tract. So that's the first problem. So blood has come in here, if you follow the arrows. Now it's already narrow. So the next thing is the volume of blood that can go into the ventricle is decreased instantly because you don't just don't have the space. Then this thick muscle, it doesn't relax as it should. So the space is physically narrow, the muscle can't relax. You have decreased filling of the left ventricle. That's clear to everybody? So the first thing that does over time, it means blood is backing up into the left atrium. So this can become dilated, but also it means blood is backing up into the lungs, so you get pulmonary congestion and edema, left heart failure, okay? Okay, so then the next problem is, now blood needs to leave. Look at the space it has to leave through. So this thing here is a part of the mitral valve. This arrow is showing you the very narrow channel. So, not enough space for blood to leave, so it means that the amount of blood leaving, apart from the fact that the ventricle couldn't fill enough, now in addition, it doesn't have enough space to leave, so even less is leaving. The third problem, when blood comes in here, this part of the mitral valve slaps against here and closes it further. And that is why this condition is associated with sudden death, especially related to exercise. So we hear that classic scenario, athletes, they collapse on the field. This is not the only cause of that, but this is one cause. So as you exercise, or if there's any reason you actually need more oxygen, then the heart would typically fill more, get more blood out to systemic, so you can have more ATP generation, more oxygenation, etc. This cannot happen here. And so as the patient's oxygen demand goes up and the left ventricle tries to fill, the mitral valve is slapping against that narrow outflow and stopping blood from exiting. So oxygenated blood is not getting to the tissues, okay? It's not even getting to the coronaries to perfuse the heart muscle. And these patients can collapse and die from arrhythmia or from sudden cardiogenic shock, yes? The outflow tract. So it's a problem all the time in them, but if they don't have increased cardiac output and it's not extreme, they can go undiagnosed because they're just living their life, it's not noticeable. But then, so definitely, depending on when the manifestation in the heart begin, then that kind of has to do with when the patient presents. But once you get to this kind of stage where there's a lot of hypertrophy, very narrow outflow tract, yes, when you have increased demand and the heart is trying to fill more to get more oxygenated blood out, that mitral valve, when the blood is passing here, that valve is hitting against the narrow channel. And some patients actually have a fibrotic patch right where the mitral valve keeps hitting the septum. That's clear to everyone? Okay, so clinical consequences, atrial fibrillation and ventricular arrhythmias. Okay, you have atrial dilatation, you stretch the wall and the septum, the interatrial septum. You have hypertrophy of the ventricular septum. You have patchy fibrosis in the muscle. So they're at risk for arrhythmias. Plus you have ischemic events as well. They can have thrombi, neural thrombi. We mentioned that, how that works already. Intractable heart failure. And we mentioned how sudden death happens. Some of them, the sudden death is from arrhythmias. So when I was training, I had a teenager. She was known to have this condition. She was with her family and friends in one of these water parks. She came off, was running around. They were doing the water slides. She did a water slide. She came off the water slide, went under the water, and never resurfaced. It was shallow, so it wasn't drowning. And because we knew her underlying condition and nothing was found at autopsy, then the assumption is that she died from, when she hit the cold water, she may have had an arrhythmia then and died. Okay? Okay, so last of the major types, and then we'll mention a very uncommon type, the last of the last uncommon type briefly. Restrictive cardiomyopathy. So in this condition, we mentioned something is causing the ventricles to be stiff. So in other words, you have decreased ventricular compliance. And this means that the ventricles cannot fill as they should. So this is again a diastolic dysfunction. This can be idiopathic, and this is another of the conditions where more and more genes are being discovered. So that the idiopathic group is shrinking. And I'm not troubled overall, but I know that in children, those that used to be called idiopathic, up to about 70% of those now have genes related to them. Can be familial or non-familial when there is a known genetic disorder. Well, it can just be familial or non-familial, whether we know the gene or not. And for the genes that are known, some of them are inherited autosomal dominant and some autosomal recessive. So in adults, secondary causes are well known. So this can include storage and infiltrative disorders. So one of the more common conditions is amyloidosis. Patients who have radiation, they get fibrosis of the myocardium. So understandably, that myocardium will not be able to relax if it's filled with fibrous tissue. Same thing, if amyloid deposits, it deposits all in the muscle, then that myocardium cannot relax because it's filled with this waxy material. Sarcoidosis, remember that's the granulomatous inflammation. It can involve the heart. Tumors that infiltrate the heart. And there's some inborn errors of metabolism where you can get storage of different metabolites in the myocardium. So here is one example. On its own, if you just look at it casually, it's not like really dramatic except for the atrial dilatation, which is understandable because, so this patient had some rare condition, don't worry about it, some kind of fibrotic and eosinophilic disorder. That's not the important part. I just wanted to show you one, because the important thing to know in restrictive, the appearance of the heart can vary. It's the function that is the same. They all have stiff ventricles. So sometimes the heart is, you know, normal to small. sometimes there's ventricular hypertrophy depending on the cause. So for instance, if it's something depositing in the myocardium, then you expect the heart to grow. But if it's just fibrosis, you may not have ventricular hypertrophy. Is that clear? But as you can imagine, if there is resistance to the filling of the ventricles, then the atria dilate. So this is what this heart is illustrating. Massive atrial dilatation. Here is one with hypertrophy. This patient had amyloidosis. And so this myocardium is expanded by deposition of the amyloid in between the muscle cells. So these stiff ventricles, you have decreased ventricular filling as a result and decreased cardiac output. So clearly not good. The patients have heart failure. In addition, the atria will dilate, and then blood on the left side, blood is backing up in the lungs, causing pulmonary edema and congestion. On the right side, it's backing up in the systemic circulation, as we see in right heart failure. So you've done heart failure now. Remember, congestive cardiac failure means both left, you have both left-sided and right-sided heart failure. And remember, dilated atria, they are prone to atrial fibrillation and of course the thrombus formation. On the left side, the continuous backup into the lung and continuous high pressures in the lung, eventually the patients can develop pulmonary hypertension. Okay, so last one we're going to talk about, quite uncommon, but we do see it from time to time. Way back when I was a resident, I had one case. And I've since had another case as a consultant. So it used to be called right ventricular dysplasia, right ventricular cardiomyopathy. The current term is arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy. So this is inherited as an autosomal dominant condition. So one of my friends, not in Jamaica, one of her friends in his 40s, went to the gym. This is a family friend. He went to the gym, he was exercising, he collapsed at the gym, he could not be resuscitated, and he died. And they found this condition. And so then they investigated the family and found a few other members who also, unknown to everyone, have this condition. So mainly young men, but my last patient was a woman. Right ventricular wall is severely thinned from loss of the cardiac myocytes, and they are replaced with fat and with fibrous tissue, mainly with fat. So the right ventricle cannot function. There's right ventricular failure, and there are rhythm disturbances, in other words, arrhythmias. And these arrhythmias can typically cause sudden death. The fat can also be on the left side, but it's typically right ventricular. So here's what it looks like. So here is some normal heart muscle. That's by the septum, just to show you, remind you what it looks like. Here is the free wall of the right ventricle filled with fat. You can still see some muscle where the papillary muscles and trabecular are. These are trabecular of the right ventricle. And then if you go on histology, we use the stain. The stain stains muscle red and fibrous tissue blue-green. So you can see the red muscle on the inside. That's where you have the trabecular and the papillary muscle. But all of this should be myocardium. It's all white from fat, and only a thin layer of myocardium is there. Okay, so this is a classic case. Okay, so those are the four types. Clearly, our focus is on these three: hypertrophic, dilated, and restrictive. All right, I think we have at least 5 minutes. It's 10 to, so we can do the two cases as opposed to just leaving it with you. So here is case number one. As I said, I told you the answer already, but let's look at the picture. So this child, I think, was about 18 months, had a viral illness, then presented very ill, was found to have heart failure, progressed rapidly over 48 hours. They couldn't control it and the baby died. This was her heart. I'll tell you the parameters, but let's look at it. So we're looking at the open left side, inflow tract, left atrium, mitral valve, left ventricle. Outflow tract, the blood is coming from behind here. Then it comes around to leak through the aorta. So this is the septum here. So this is what the endocardium looks like. Even thinner than that, it's translucent normally over the muscle. This is endocardial fiber elastosis, thick and white. It's here, but it's worse in this inflow tract area. And you can see when you look at this one, the globular appearance of the dilated left ventricle. So this heart was about two times normal, more than two for the baby's age. The ventricles were dilated. We know this because the mitral and tricuspid valves were dilated. Their circumference was increased. And of course, I showed you the endocardial fibroelastosis. The ventricular wall thickness was normal. The valve morphology was normal. The coronary artery circulation was normal. And there were features of congestive cardiac failure. So I told you the diagnosis. This is a classic case of dilated cardiomyopathy. All right, so let's up it a little. So now, this is a cross-section going anterior-posterior across the ventricles of this patient's heart. Over here would be the right ventricle, cavity, free wall. Left ventricle, free wall, cavity, and here is the interventricular septum. So can we agree that there's left ventricular, concentric left ventricular hypertrophy? Everybody can appreciate that, right? This has resulted in narrowing of the cavity, by the way, because it's so severe. I don't know if you can agree with me that it looks a little glassy appearing, but that's okay. So on microscopic examination, there was pink acellular material in the myocardium. And then we did this histochemical stain called Congo red stain. And we performed it on the myocardium and it was positive. Does anyone know what this stain is for? For amyloid, right? Very good. So the Congo red stain is a stain we apply in histology, and what we call a special stain. It's a histochemical stain. And when there is amyloid, it stains brick red. And then we can polarize it, and under polarizing polarizing light under the microscope, it gives neon green, what we call apple green birefringent. It looks like neon green. And so this is what we found in this patient. So what type of cardiomyopathy does this patient have, therefore? Restrictive, and is it primary or secondary? Right, so this patient has secondary restrictive restrictive cardiomyopathy secondary to amyloidosis. Okay, excellent. No, this one is symmetric. Symmetric, all around is the same. But at your stage, asymmetric left ventricular hypertrophy is seen in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Most of the time, otherwise, it is symmetric. So in other words, the septum and the free wall have similar thickness. And that's why you can see it concentric, as concentric hypertrophy.
Oh, so you're saying that the hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is the only situation that you see asymmetric?
Yes, at your stage. Okay? It's the main cause anyway. In hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, yes. So occasionally you don't see that classic thing, and those patients, of course, tend to do better. Any other questions? Okay, so as I said, so the three cardiac lectures that I've done, they're in a folder for you, PDF copies. And I put it on the desktop here. okay, you're not rid of me though. I think I'll be seeing you in another 2 weeks and continuously thereafter until the end of the school year.